Hey everyone, Ryan Orwig here from StatMed Learning, and I'm here to talk about the single most important med study skill, retrieval practice. So a question we get asked a lot by our med students and doctors goes something like this. After watching lecture and then reading the material one time, what's the best thing I should do next? The answer, well, it's complicated. A lot of people say, I want to review the material as many times as possible before the test. I want to reread it. I want to look over it. I want to see it all again 3 to 5 times. Personally, I do not want our next experience or any of our experiences to be review based. So my simple answer is avoid the allure of review and get right to retrieval practice. So what am I talking about? Review is when the learner directly rereads, looks over, or skims material they've already studied when the information is in front of their face. This is how most students spend their time, and it is not high yield. Review is passive, it's inefficient, and creates what I call the trap of familiarity. This is a trap that we spring on ourselves. Rereading or looking over material we've already studied entrenches familiarity instead of building robust memory. In other academic arenas, supreme familiarity might have been enough to make incredible grades, to make your life really good and successful. But once you get to medical school or board prep study, how does familiarity treat you? I mean, I know how it treats you. It's enough to let you narrow down to 2 or 3 answer options on the test and say, I'm sure it's one of them, but I don't know which one it is because my knowledge only goes 3 feet deep and it needs to go 5 feet deep. This is a byproduct of relying on review as a primary study methodology. And let me just say, if review works for you at the level you're at, more power to you. It definitely works for a lot of med students and physicians. But with StatMed Learning, we are here to help those who need better learning methods. Anyway, moving on. Why else do we rely on review? Well, because recognition feels good. When we are looking at the information that we've already studied and it is right there in front of our faces, we experience what I call the yep, I got it phenomenon, because that's kind of the transaction that's going on in your head between you and the text. You're saying, yep, I totally have that as it's there in front of my face, which is exactly how it's not going to be presented on test day. And that underscores my biggest issue with review. It doesn't demand struggle with recall. Using the right kind of effort is key for optimal learning. This is one of the things that learning science tells us. But just sitting there and putting in the effort to make yourself sit in a chair for 12 hours and study, it's commendable and it's impressive, but it's not the right kind of effort. Making yourself read over and review the same stuff over and over again. Admirable effort, but not the right kind of effort. Without forcing recall, which review does not force recall, without metaphorically sweating it out, we're failing to tap into the biggest key for maximizing learning, which is unlocking that effort that comes with trying to recall information. So all that is why I'm not a big fan of relying on review. Instead, I want us to think more about retrieval practice. This is when learners force themselves to try and recall information that they've already studied, followed by an immediate self-check from the source to solidify knowledge by correcting what was missed and corroborating and reinforcing what was recalled. Forcing retrieval requires using the right kind of effort. Trying and failing to recall something is better than just looking over or reviewing the topic and recognizing it, whatever that means. When we wrestle with attempting recall, we are tapping into the right kind of effort, like working out a muscle to exhaustion, instead of stopping the workout when we feel a slight sweat coming on. Retrieval practice doesn't feel good, so we're less inclined to do it. Retrieval practice is not fun. It's hard. It makes us feel bad because we don't remember as much as we want. So we have to engineer an understanding that while it doesn't feel good, it is indeed good for you. The act of attempting recall directly builds better memories and retrieval pathways, which should be the goal of studying. And learners often engage in this activity too little or too late. Look, the fact that we're not teaching this at every level of education, starting at like elementary school, is a staggering cultural failing. Don't even get me started. But for our purposes, we encourage all of our students to engage in some form of retrieval practice early and often when you start learning a new topic. So we prescribe a 3-step process for every time you engage in retrieval practice. We always start with, of course, choosing the material. It can't be too big, can't be too small. It's got to be just right, a little bit of a Goldilocks principle at play. It's a skill you develop. Then you attempt the recall. Explicitly try to recall the information, ideally writing it out or talking it out. You can't hide from what you know and what you don't know if you write it out or talk it out. I think it's a great way to add other modalities, and it's a way to not cheat yourself. And then, of course, you have to follow it immediately with a self-check of the source material. Ideally, that source material has been marked in a way to help facilitate and speed up the self-check process. So now, let's look at a simple example of how we might deploy some retrieval practice in some basic study. So let's say we're going through a lecture on mediastinitis. Well, first we have to choose what we're going to self-test on. Let's just pick this definition slide. And then what's the simplest way to do this? Well, you just simply use the heading or the subheading as a prompt, cover up the details, and then try to retrieve the information contained within, writing it out as much as you can, and then quickly get to the self-check, see what you got right, see what you got wrong. This is where the learning happens. Now let's look at a more nuanced form of this. So let's take the mediastinitis piece. While in lecture and while reading, we mark it up so it looks something like this. And notice how it's not just like underlining and highlighting to say it's important. We can now use these structural indicators to quiz ourselves. So you can see here, these are quizzable subcategories that are written in the margins. And then all of the markings within the body of the text are made to help make self-checking easier. So now when I come back, I can self-test, I can self-check, and I'm avoiding the trap of review, the trap of familiarity, and I'm actually doing good, industrious work. The third and final example comes from a family medicine doctor's personal notes she was making when restudying for family medicine. And there's a problem here with her notes. The way they are written to set up and facilitate review, not retrieval practice. So how do we fix this? Well, you can see, I like that there's information in there. I like that it's hierarchical. We can see that she's got like two main things we're looking at up top. We can see some subcategories under traveler's diarrhea. We can see agent treatment here. We can see that this chart is broken into some subcategories with some details, all delineated the answers within. I don't want her going back and reviewing this document. She doesn't know what she precisely knows, what she's vaguely familiar with, but doesn't precisely know, and then what she's just forgotten. It's all going to look familiar for her. So how do we fix this? So what we do is we take her document and we're going to put it on a new sheet of paper and we're going to break it into two halves. On the left side, we're going to put the structural prompts. So these are sort of the prompts, the placeholders. And then we're going to draw a line here. We're going to add on the other side the answers. So we're going to go right in there and write them in. We're writing in a few of the subcategories, but there's not a lot of redundancy here. So now we've created this two-sided document. It's far better than the original document, which was set up to promote review. In the new document, it's set up to facilitate retrieval practice. Now we can use this left-hand side with these structure-based prompts to quiz ourselves and then immediately self-check on the other side. The trap there would be not self-testing, not forcing retrieval, and simply reading over it in a review style. We have to hold ourselves accountable. We have to value that this is going to help us solidify our learning, be more active, be more engaged, and make our effort pay off. So in conclusion, retrieval practice is the single most important study skill that any med student or physician can add to their study toolkit. Just keep in mind, don't obsess about doing it perfectly or comprehensively. Just try to roll it in to say 10% of your study day. Grow it from there. Or perhaps set aside 30 minutes and focus on doing 30 minutes of retrieval practice and see how that takes hold and what the payoffs are. There are other ways you can mix retrieval practice into your daily study routine. You can just use your phone and record question-answer audio files, and then you can listen to it and quiz yourself on the go. on long commutes, on hikes, on walks, on moderate to light exercise. It's much better than passively sitting there and trying to absorb some pre-recorded lecture. You can always add time to any retrieval activity. I think it's one of the best things you can do because why? Everything that's going to ever matter in your career, from tests to performing on rotations, is going to happen under time circumstances. So why not bring that in to your daily study routine? It's only upside. If there are any other tools out there that are already pre-built, by all means, use them. I don't care what they are. As long as you use them, they work for you, and they can fold in some of this retrieval practice stuff. Anki is the most popular of these platforms. I think it's great for a lot of people because it's all about retrieval practice. It's about effort, and it's about distributed revisitations. Now, there's a fourth element that throws some people off. This is for the people that usually don't find the value of Anki, and that's because Anki builds from the details upward. There are a lot of students out there. They need the superstructure provided up front, and then they can house the details. We teach that skill specifically in the StatMed class, as well as all this other stuff with retrieval practice. So if you're interested in that stuff, please reach out to us. But hopefully you can find value in just this lecture alone. Start planting those seeds. Start bringing retrieval practice into your daily study routine. Thanks for watching.